less than 50 years. Any other folkloric music in the world did not manage to do that for hundreds and hundreds of years, you know. So that's, there's something magic about jazz generally.
Do you think that jazz defines humanity in some
way? Definitely. It's it's considered the music of the modern people today, you know, people who like life, love life, they have they want to enjoy, they you know, it present love, freedom, respect, so many things, you know.
The beats.
Some kind of, like, sometimes I believe that each artist has a call. He gets a call, and how determined should an artist be to answer this call or to later chase his dream, if we could call it a dream later?
Well, I everything happened with me naturally, you know. I mean, what I dreamed in my life, I managed doing it, you know, when I was a little kid. I was fascinated about jazz, and I used to listen to it, and I loved it. And I watched a movie that was made about a great drummer. It was like my idol, you know. He was the first star drummer in jazz world.
Jim Krupa
in the 30s. And you know, immediately my dream was to be able to you know, be like this man. And you know, that's why I went to the States, and I tried to study and play, and I did, you know, and I did play with a lot of great guys. And when I came back to Egypt, I made the opening of the opera house with Dizzy Gillespie, the giant Dizzy Gillespie. And I've been trying to promote this kind of music, and
actually, you later on you developed it to a kind of an oriental jazz.
Yes, but that's a different style. At the beginning, what I wanted to do is that I wanted to, you know, because I'm like the founder of this music in this country, I want people to know about it, to know about jazz, where it came from, what the different styles that jazz presented.
Yes.
And at the end, you know, just after I did all that for many, many years, I came to that to materialize another dream, which is trying to mix the jazz music with our own Egyptian
heritage.
Music, and trying to create a new sound, you know, and create a new style of music and a new kind of Egyptian music that will be, you know, affected by, has that international touch and the jazz feel and all these things, and I manage, I'm very happy.
So when you're abroad, how do foreigners react to this new genre of
music? They love it. I travel with this music everywhere. Mm-hmm. You know, we go to lots of different festivals around the world, in Europe and South Africa. We go to places in Africa also, Nigeria, Sudan. We went to Europe, Italy, Greece, Bulgaria, Serbia, you know, Austria. We were in Austria recently. Mm-hmm. We were in Morocco recently. We're going to Russia next month. We have a concert at one of the opera house theaters over there, and I think it's going to be just fine. We're happy.
We're happy too. Could you tell me more about the Yahya Khalil Foundation for the Culture of Jazz?
Yes, it's a fine foundation that I've been having this foundation for quite some time, so I can be able to do through the foundation. I can spread out the culture of jazz music and be able to do festivals and do workshops and do concerts and do documentaries and show movies and travel around the world and help young people, and it's happening and everything is fine, and I'm happy, and I thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you so much. Sure. We had a blast in the concert, and I had a blast in the interview. Thank you so much. We wish you all the best.
Thank you. Thanks.
To the end of this special episode of The Beat. I really hope that you've enjoyed it as much as we did, and until we see you again, feel the beat.
Yeah. محمد عبدو، مصطفى كامل، محمد فريد، قاسم أمين، and Saad Zaghloul had a dream which they considered far-fetched but not impossible. They dreamt that Egyptians could eventually be able to enter the university in Egypt and not travel abroad to receive such education. The question was, how? And the answer, a national university. Of December 1908 that the dream became a reality. A grand celebration was held to mark the inauguration of the Egyptian National University. It was held in the Qawaneen Hall in the Shura Council. And of course, Kedev Abbas II was on top of the attendance. Lectures started far before a permanent campus for the university was built. Students attended lectures in three places: the Shura Council Qawaneen Hall, Dar al-Jarida, and the Higher Schools Club. Eventually, Senator Janakli's palace was switched into a campus for the National University. Currently, the American University in Cairo stands in its place. Later, in a move meant to minimize expenditures, the university was transferred to Mohammed Sidi Palace in El Falaki Street off El Azhar Square. It was university policy to offer honor roll students scholarships to Europe to receive postgraduate studies and PhD degrees. Among the candidates were Taha Hussein, Mansour Fahmi, and Ahmad Dhif. In 1917, the government decided to establish a permanent campus for the National University. 5 years later, it was decided that the schools of law and medicine be part of this university, which comprised till that date the Faculty of Arts only. On the 11th of March 1925, an official decree was passed founding the Egyptian University, which encompassed the faculties of science, arts, medicine, and law. In the same year, the Faculty of Pharmacy became part of the Faculty of Medicine. A few years later, the university was transferred to its current location. The mid-30s witnessed yet another addition. A royal decree was issued. According to it, the schools of engineering, agriculture, commerce, and veterinary medicine became part of the university. In 1946, Dar al-Uloom joined in as well.